good things happen when you have an environment of commitment and dedication. Not just talked about, but lived. Lessons of our past, issues of our future.
Hello, everyone. I'm Curtis Fuller, and welcome to Issues. Today, what a special treat I have for you, because this month, really, marks the 50th anniversary of the Freedom Riders. And no doubt you've been hearing a lot about this, but these are young people who back in the 1960s set out to literally change the world. And they did that by getting on buses and making sure that everyone had the right to ride buses throughout this country and face a lot of hardships that many of us probably could not deal with today. But what an amazing story. And with me is one of those individuals who took that journey, and her name is Betty Roseman. And first of all, welcome.
Thank you.
You know, I start to think, where do I begin on this? Why don't we, first of all, if there is someone who might not know what the Freedom Riders all about, explain to them how that all came about in terms of that particular movement.
Well, as you well know, the government issued a ruling, the ICC ruling. The whole South, growing up in the South, the whole South was segregated. We had segregated schools, transportation, bus stations, F.W. Woolworth, everything was segregated. Now, a group of young people, well, first CORE, which is the Congress of Race Equality, they organized, and they are in New York. CORE decided that they would test the ruling to see if it was being complied with. If the signs that said white only, colored, were coming down, and we would be able to go and sit down wherever we wanted to, or travel and not be in fear or arrested for going into a white only restroom, a restaurant. CORE organized a group of young people. They were students, and it was a mixed group. It was black, white, there were a couple of German, whatever. Students came together, and they started in Washington, D.C. on May 4th. They decided they would get on a bus, a Greyhound, and they would travel to New Orleans. And everywhere along the route, they would stop and test the facilities to see if they were complying with what the ruling said. And as you know, they ran into a lot of trouble. This was the first Freedom Ride group that left Washington. And this is what we're celebrating now, the 50th anniversary. That was May 4th, 1961. They left Washington, headed for New Orleans. We were waiting in New Orleans for them to arrive.
Because you lived in New Orleans at the
Yes,
time.
I lived in New Orleans. I had already joined CORE because we were working before the first Freedom Rider. We were picketing Woolworth. We had a lot of segregated places in New Orleans. So that night we were going to hold a rally. And when they arrived, we were going to welcome them and listen to them. And of course, you know, they didn't make it. The bus was bombed in Anniston, Alabama. They were beaten, and it was a terrible incident. Hank Thomas was on that bus. Hank Thomas is the godfather of my oldest daughter. And there were friends on that bus, and it was just terrible. So this started a movement, and the movement caught on in different states. Our New Orleans CORE group, we joined in. I think the first group that joined them was from Nashville, Tennessee. And of course, you know Diane Nash.
Absolutely.
And of course, they were really, really dedicated. And of course, the government didn't want any buses, any other buses, to come into Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana. But of course, they said the buses are going to keep coming.
And I think what is so powerful about this story and why it's so important that we celebrate it is our young people today need to realize that these were young people. You were 21 at the time.
Yes.
These were young people dramatically impacting our country and our world. I think people know how young Dr. King was at the time, but people forget that he was that young.
Yes.
You know, he, if I'm not mistaken, he was only in his early 30s when he did the I Have a Dream speech. He was only 26, if I remember correctly, when he started at Dexter Baptist Church in Alabama. So these were young people impacting our world.
Yes, some of the people were still in their teens. There were people 19, 18, and they were all young people. A lot of them were college students, but a lot of them still were not yet in college. But they joined together, and they had one goal, one motivation, one dedication. And I can truly say I have never met young people like the young people we worked with back then.
I want to take a break and then ask the obvious question, you know, because you could have easily stayed on the sidelines and gotten involved maybe in another way, but to actually put your life on the line, I mean literally, I'll ask you why you decided to do that. But we'll take a break and we'll be back in just a moment. Welcome back, everyone. I'm Curtis Fuller, and I am speaking to Betty Roseman, and she is a freedom writer, and we are talking about the story now 50 years old, but, you know, 50 years, we say it like it sounds like it's a long time ago, but it really is not that long ago, and you think about all the changes that have occurred in 50 years as you were telling that story. It's hard to even put our mind around things happening like that and the violence that existed just because people were trying to open doors, and the fact that so many people fought as equally hard to keep those doors shut. It's pretty amazing, pretty amazing. But I said that I would ask you, why you? Why did you say it was necessary for you to get involved in the movement?
Well, growing up in New Orleans and in a situation where everything was segregated, I can remember many times wanting to go somewhere and not being able to go. I can remember my younger brother, when he was not even a teenager, wanting to be in the soapbox derby. And he built the nicest little soapbox, and he was not allowed after going through all of that simply because of the color of his skin. So when you put everything together, what we were going through, I had to do what I had to do because things were not right. I knew that we were all equal. I knew that we were as good as anybody else. So we needed to have rights like everybody else. And I joined because I knew I could make a difference.
Happy that we're celebrating this and telling this story again?
Oh, yes. I will tell it every opportunity I get because our young people, everybody need to know what some people have gone through. There were many unsung heroes. Their names are not in a history book, but they went through much, and some even lost their lives in the struggle. And I think that it needs to be told.
I'll ask you, because we have only read about, I've been blessed that I've had a chance to meet a lot of civil rights giants like Fred Shuttlesworth and others. But tell me about your perspective as 21 at the time, and at that time, Dr. King was just emerging, Fred Shuttlesworth emerging on the national scene. Give me your take on some of those individuals as you saw them then.
Well, I can tell you, I guess I always had an interest. I always knew that we were somebody, but we were held back. I can remember Dr. King came. I was in school that day, and he came to New Orleans, and they would not let him speak at the municipal auditorium. And I can remember we left school, we said, if we get in trouble, we're going to get in trouble, but we're going to see Dr. King. We didn't get in to see him, but as he was leaving, he did walk past us, and he tapped us on the head, and he told us to stay in school, keep up the good work. How come we were not in school? And we told him we wanted to see him. When Emmett Till's mother came to New Orleans for a rally, I was young. I went to see her. I was always wanting to know about things. And when you add it all up, when you put it all together, you know you have to do something to make a difference and change it.
Wow. New Orleans. And we see New Orleans mm-hmm. as this open, pretty vibrant town, but it was very much segregated back
yes.
then.
There were separate schools, the city buses, you had to relinquish your seat if someone wanted it. There were signs that said white only. And even if it was not crowded and they had a seat, if they wanted your seat, you had to get up and move all the way to the back of the bus, whether there were seats or not. So we went through a lot. And there was the high school in New Orleans I always admired because I would see them in the kind of a parade, their marching band, and I thought, they're really neat. And I wanted to go to that school, but we were not allowed because we had segregated schools.
I want you to tell the story of, you were saying there were so many unsung heroes.
And yes.
The one person who probably saved your life, tell that story as.
We went on a freedom ride, the New Orleans core group, it was six of us. And we went from New Orleans to Mobile, Alabama. There was a rally. When we left Mobile, we were told before we left not to get arrested if we could help it. If we were asked to leave, get up and leave. We complied with that, but on the way back, we stopped in a little town called Poplarville, Mississippi.
You'll never forget
I'll
it.
I'll never forget Poplarville. Sometime when we go to New Orleans, my children asked me, Mama, would you like to ride through Poplarville just to see what it looks like? And my answer is no. I'm not getting off the interstate. We're going to continue. Poplarville, Mississippi had a little bus station. When the Greyhound bus pulled in, there were six of us, five young ladies, black, and one young man, white. Now, three of them were to get off and go into the station and test the facility. Three of us remained on the bus, but I was assigned the job of making a phone call if something happened along the way. Now, we didn't have cell phones in 1961. I had to find a phone booth. I saw a phone booth across the street by a gas station. I got off, I went over to the gas station, but before I got off the bus, the three people that had gone into the station were physically drug out of the station, put into the back of a pickup truck, and the truck drove off. It was a crowd of white men that had run up on the side, and they were jeering and cheering, and they drove off with our three people. I went across to make the phone call, and while I was in the phone booth, two of our young ladies were still on the bus. The bus pulled off and left me. Here I am stranded, 8:00 at night, Poplarville, Mississippi, in a phone booth. Now, Poplarville had a luncheon 2 years earlier, and the name of the person that was killed there was Mac Parker Jr. And that was all over the news. As I made my call, I did make contact with CORE in New Orleans. But then I saw and I heard commotion, and there was another mob had gathered, and they were on the other side, but they were looking for me.
Hold your thought, because I have to take a break. I hate to interrupt you. But I want to take this break, and we will pick up right where you left off when we come back. Welcome back. We're talking to Betty Roseman. You were telling this story where you took part in a freedom ride to Mississippi, Poplarville, Mississippi. So pick up where you had just left off.
I heard a commotion on the other side of the street, and it was maybe a dozen white men had gathered, and they were shouting and saying, someone else got off the bus. I won't use the language. The bus pulled off. When I went in the phone booth, the driver, either out of fear or whatever, for whatever reason, he pulled off and left me. So I'm stranded in a strange town, 8 o'clock at night. I wasn't really afraid. I knew that whatever happened was gonna happen. And I managed to see a black man working in a gas station right there. And he came out and he looked across the street to see what the commotion was, and he heard him, and he stood there. And as he stood there, I managed to get his attention. And he came near the phone booth, and I told him, they're looking for me. Can you please help me? And he said, stay down in the booth. I'll see what I can do. And I heard him talking to two white men in the station, and he was saying, I need to use the truck. I've got an emergency. I've got to go home. I've got an emergency. And he must have been accustomed to that, and they let him take the truck. He drove over near the phone booth. He opened the door on the passenger side, told me to get in, stay down on the floor. He said, I will take you to the highway, and maybe you can get a ride back to New Orleans. Instead, we stopped at two black families in Poplarville, but they said no, they couldn't let me stay there. And one old lady said it best. She said, we've had one lynching, and she said, they will come looking for you, and they will find you, and we can't go through another lynching. So he said, I will take you to the highway, and maybe you can get a ride from here to New Orleans. New Orleans was about 85 miles, I later found out. On the way to the highway, he was praying. He was an elderly man, but he was praying. And I could hear him. He was saying, Lord, help me. I can't do this. Tell me what to do. He said, I have 8 children. Lord, tell me what to do. And when we got to the highway, he said, I can't put you out. I'm gonna drive you on to New Orleans. He said, but if they tell the story, we would get killed. My family would be in danger and I would be in danger. We got to New Orleans and the head of Corps, I went in and got her, and she came out to the car, she talked to him, and he said, I must get back because they may figure it out. However, I don't know, I didn't know his name.
Never knew his name.
He would never give her, he didn't give her the information. He couldn't be revealed. He did not want it known. We waited years. We covered the story kind of up in order to protect him and his family. And I'm trying to find out who he was. Even lately, I contacted a church in Poplarville that I saw on a program from a convention, and the minister was a little reluctant. He said, I remember the story, and I said, well, can you tell me who the man was? I'm sure he's not alive now. And he said, all I can tell you is he did not live in Poplarville. He only worked there. So that told me he knew who it was.
Right. That's an amazing story. And there were so many other amazing stories like that. And I think we have about less than 2 minutes left. In this time span since then, what's been the most dramatic change you've seen? I mean, you've had an election of Barack Obama. Obviously, all that's related to the King holiday. What's been the most dramatic change you've seen?
Well, number one is our president. I am so excited about a black president. I can remember in 1950s, my mom trying to register to vote. And they were tested. Black people had to take a test in New Orleans. And there were outrageous questions such as, how black is midnight? And you fail a test over things that you couldn't possibly answer. So I was very excited when she finally did get to vote. And her first vote came for President John F. Kennedy. That was the first time my mother voted. And I was very excited. So I never thought I would live to see history made in the election of President Obama. So that's the biggest change I've seen.
Well, you are history. Happy birthday, belated.
Thank you.
Just turned 72 this month. Thank you. Thank you. And that's so understated for everything you've done for all of us. We'll be back in a moment. Hey, before we get away, I want to just tell you about something coming up in June. It's called the Soul of Summer Tour with jazz artist Jonathan Butler, Eric Darius, and Mesa. It takes place Friday, June 17th, 7 o'clock at the Kingsgate Marriott Hotel. Tickets for this event, $50, can be purchased by calling this number. You see it there on the screen, to 513-733-1550. And, oh, I'm sorry. 1555. That's what happens when you don't put on your glasses, huh? Hey, finally, I just wanted to note the passing of a civil rights giant, and that's Bishop Nathaniel Lindsay. Many of you know that he spent close to 10 years here in Cincinnati, but he was a childhood friend of Martin Luther King Jr. and really fought hard in the civil rights movement. Just passed away recently, and so keep his family in your prayers at this time. And again, my thanks to Betty Roseman, and pass this story along to our young people. Let them know that history is still among them. There are people around who can tell them those stories that took place just 50 years ago. And I know sometimes it seems like a long time, but it really wasn't that long ago. I'm Curtis Fuller. Have a nice day. We'll be right back.